Hello, everyone. My name is Anne-Marie, and I'm your host for the second episode of The Den. In this episode, I'll be narrating the most eerie and frightening true paranormal experiences from our community. So, prepare yourselves for a spine-chilling adventure. Without further ado, let's begin. It's been a while since this happened, but from what I can recall, I was about 10 when this happened. My parents and I went out one night to go dine at this popular restaurant. For privacy reasons, I won't be revealing the name of the restaurant, but please know that this experience was what caused the restaurant to move locations. Back then, only the front lawn of the newly opened restaurant was available for the customers to use, while the actual building was closed off. So, with the front lawn being completely occupied, they allowed us to dine inside the actual building. The furniture were still covered when we entered, so they removed the plastic sheets off one of the tables for us. After a couple minutes of enjoying our dinner, I felt an urge to go to the toilet. My mother asked the waiter serving us to lead us to the toilet, and so he did. For the sake of clarity, I'll insert the layout of the place here. This was our table, and the toilet that the waiter led us to was located inside the VIP room. After using the toilet, I closed the door of the VIP room and continued on with my food. After a while, my mother proposed that I stand beside one of the little elephant statues for a photo, and I did. So she took a photo of me and accidentally took another photo while I was running back to my seat. Like before, I proceeded to eat my food until I heard my mom gasp. When I looked over to her, she had her phone screen turned towards me with the photo of me standing beside the little elephant statue on display. My eyes bulged out as I saw a white smoke-like figure hovering beside me in the photo. I laughed it off, trying to convince myself with reasonable explanations like it might have been a fingerprint stain on the camera or a glitch on the phone because, after all, it is a Nokia keypad phone. Until my mother showed me the second photo. I felt my heart drop when I saw the photo, which was of my face with a white, unsightly looking hand covering half of it. My mother showed the photos to the waiter and he relayed them to the restaurant's owner. Horrified, they asked us not to spread the photos. We respected their request and prepared ourselves to leave the restaurant. Before reaching the exit, I checked the door to the VIP room and it was opened, even though I was so sure that I had the door closed. That sent chills down my spine. It would have been a whole lot creepier if we could see the photos, but the reason why a newly opened restaurant, a popular one, moved locations. The photos must have been really, really, really eerie and even possibly sinister. Hi, I would like to share my paranormal experiences with you all. If any of you might have knowledge of ways to resolve these issues, please let me know. So, I'll begin with my story. To provide context, there are two doors to my front gate, one being the actual gate and the other being the smaller door on the gate that allows people to enter to and from the house. We had this smaller door opened at all times since it makes things easier for the workers at our home to enter and exit the house. We're neighbors with a couple who works at the embassy. Since there's only two of them living, they would usually invite our family to join them to have snacks while chatting with them. One night, around 9 p.m., we came back to our house after visiting them. Upon arriving at our front gate, we realized that the smaller door that I previously mentioned was open. We didn't think much of it since our driver tends to pull pranks on us like this. But after we entered our house and turned back to lock the door, we saw the door lock itself right in front of our eyes. Out of fear, we ran into the house and did not look back at all. I tried to figure out possible explanations as to why that had occurred. Maybe it was just the wind or the elevation of the ground, but those explanations didn't seem very plausible when I think about it, because I remember wearing a thin blouse since it wasn't windy or chilly that night, and the ground of our front yard is fairly leveled. Moreover, how did the door lock itself right in front of our eyes? I still haven't figured it out, but one thing I do know is that I'll never be able to forget what happened that night. Well, that was one mysterious entry, but that's not where this teacher's paranormal experiences stop. There's yet another one. After I submitted my previous paranormal experience, I got reminded of another incident that occurred in this same house. However, this is not my experience, but rather my son's. When we first moved into the house, my son kept telling me that he was seeing shadowy figures from the corners of his eyes. Being the skeptic that I am, I just told him that it was normal for our eyes to see things that were not there and didn't think much about it. Fast forward a few days later, our family was having breakfast when my son broke the news that he had experienced something strange the night before.
I woke up in the middle of the night because I couldn't breathe. When I opened my eyes, I saw a man sitting on top of me who was staring at me. I panicked and forced myself to go back to bed. I think it was just a nightmare though.
A few days later, I was in the kitchen washing dishes. We had a window above the sink and I saw a slight reflection of a figure from a window, sort of like a young man, walk down the stairs and turn left. That's when I knew that there was something inhuman in our house. For some odd reason, the appearance disappeared ever since, I think. I have goosebumps right now because of this entry. I mean, a ghost sitting on top of a person, their chest, while they're asleep. But when you think about it, something as bizarre as this may seem impossible, when in reality it's pretty common. Because there's this supernatural creature called night hag or old hag, and it is often associated with sleep paralysis. So, similar to this son's experience, this creature, according to Wikipedia, is, quote, a phenomenon during which a person feels a presence of a supernatural malevolent being which immobilizes the person as if sitting on their chest or the foot of their bed. Back in the older days, sleep paralysis was often assumed to be the works of demons or just really, really negative entities wishing harm on helpless people. Some of the oldest witnesses of the night hag dates back to the 1500s. Different stories from all over the continents with the same experience. The earliest incident recorded was when this, quote, one Dutch doctor documented a patient's terrifying sleep paralysis back in the 1664. He explained that his patient felt as if the devil was lying on top of her, or a great dog was sitting on her chest. When she tried to throw it off, she couldn't move. This paranormal experience that I'll be telling you is not mine, but my aunt's, who happens to attract all kinds of paranormal activities. This time, I'll be talking about her trip to Daungji and the lady who slept beside her. My aunt went on a family trip to Daungji with my uncle, my four-year-old cousin, and two maids. The place they were to spend the night in was an old motel used by the British back in the colonial times. That night, my aunt and her family checked into the motel. The two maids had their own room, and my aunt and her family slept in another. The building was pretty old, so she could hear the water tap leaking in the bathroom and such. My aunt did not like the vibes she got from the motel, so she jokingly asked one of the maids if she wanted to sleep in the room with her.
Hey, do you want to sleep in our room tonight?
The maids replied,
no, miss, we can sleep in our own rooms.
After their conversations, they all retired to their rooms and slept. My aunt was woken up around 5 a.m. by a young lady sleeping beside her outside the mosquito tent. She asked groggily, my aunt then remembered that the maids refused her offer to spend the night with her, and her blood ran cold. Too scared to turn around, she called for my uncle, who was sleeping in the other bed. She knew she was awake at that time because she could tell it was a young lady around the same age of the maids, and it was sleeping right next to her. She muttered a few prayers and gradually fell asleep from exhaustion. The next morning, the motel owner asked her if she could sleep well. My aunt told him about her experience and he decided to confess. Back under the British rule, a young girl hanged herself here. People still believe her spirit is stuck here. If you invite someone to sleep with you and such, the spirit thinks you're talking to her and will sleep beside you. It was in early October 2020 when my husband received a call from his older sister. She sent him this video and sounded scared of what happened.
No.
Chris, my husband, who can feel their presence, just told his sister maybe it could have just been the strong wind which caused the trash can to move. He didn't want his family to be scared while taking care of our house. We flew back in November and arrived safe and sound. We had 2 weeks of home quarantine and everything seemed fine. Months passed until 2 weeks ago. I stayed up late to finish my report card comments when I heard one of our dogs scratching on my office door and barking so loud. I ignored it for 3 times until I opened the door. It rushed to the main door and angrily barked. There was no one outside when I peeked. It happened 2 times until I realized maybe it's something else. The paranormal experience that I'm going to talk about happened a couple of years ago at the front yard of the house that I'm currently living in. It was a holiday break, and a lot of my friends had come over to a get-together party. We spent the day playing games such as sports, hide and seek, and playing on the PS4. I remember being left outside with a friend. Let's call her Kathy. We were playing badminton when everyone had gone inside. That was when I felt something behind me. It was as if a presence had passed by behind me and I saw a shadow through my peripheral vision. Kathy, who was on the other side, reacted to it, mentioning exactly what I was thinking. We both laughed it off, coming to the conclusion that it was probably just my shadow because we had lights on at that time, and we continued to play. The second time though, the presence had passed Kathy. So I told her. This time, we didn't react as calmly as we did like the last. We threw our rackets to the ground and ran inside as we felt chills running down our spine. When we told the others what had happened, none of them seemed to believe us. Like I had expected. Can we blame them though? It could have been anything. Maybe it was just our shadows, or just our eyes deceiving us. But the experience felt so real, as if a person was standing behind me. You know, I really hope that never ever happens to me because that is truly terrifying. Just an entity standing, passing behind you and your friend, and you guys see it, but then no one believing you after you just experience all of that. I mean, there might have been a more plausible explanation for this occurrence, but two people experienced this simultaneously. So, you know? But whatever, I mean, okay, whatever. Let's just move on to our last submission. It's quite a long one from a teacher, so brace yourselves for this one.
I'll be home for Christmas.
In the 1970s, I was a full-fledged undergraduate in psychology at a small Midwestern college. My parents, who moved around a lot, had relocated from Minnesota to sunny California, and then for some crazy reason, moved to old New Jersey, a place not known for surfing, sand, or California girls. Instead, it was famed for thick accent, old houses, in the mafia. The story is about one old house. I arrived home to where I'd never been before. A huge four-story house, one that had been, I guess, a mansion of sorts. At any rate, some enterprising builder had divided that huge house into two halves.
I'll be home.
I never met the folks from the left, if there were ever any. It was holiday time in New Jersey, which did not mean snow, but did include festive decorations, a Christmas tree with all the old glass ornaments, lights strung around the place, candles, and of course, lots of cookies. My mom made the best cookies. However, I was home for just a short while, playing with their pet toy poodle, Rusty, one of the smartest dogs I've ever met, honestly. My mother caught me by the elbow and pulled me into the kitchen.
Steve, I don't want you to tell Tim and scare him, but I think this house is haunted.
Now remember, I was a psychology major, and not just any psychology major, but a psych tutor. founder of the college's psychology club and a rising star of the department. As a scientist, but also a son, I had to reply.
Oh, what makes you think so?
I figured Mom had gone batty from the change of coastlines. I certainly thought they were crazy for going to New Jersey. Mom got the most serious look on her face, the kind that all mothers know how to make.
There are some strange things going on in this house. There are cold spots in the hallways, strange noises at night, and Rusty will sometimes go barking up the stairs and there's no one up there at all.
And Rusty, as I knew, was a smart poodle who never barked. He was just too cool to be a dog, honestly. Whether I liked it or not, my spine tingled at my mom's story. But being the scientist that I was, in my 20-year-old wisdom, I said,
Well, there may be other explanations. It's an old house. You can tell it's settled towards the center. It's December and cold air may be coming through in from somewhere you can't see. And, you know, there might be squirrels in the attic. Everything has an explanation. There are no such things as ghosts.
Mom didn't look convinced. She said, rather harshly as I recall, Well, believe what you want to believe. Just don't tell Tim. So I didn't. Just a few days later, my brother Tim pulled me into the parlor and said,
Steve, I want to tell you something, but I don't want you to tell Mom.
I looked at him. Tim could be a prankster. I knew.
Oh, do tell. The house is haunted.
Tim's face was strangely ashen and worried. Not like Tim at all.
Weird things. Pictures falling off walls for no reason. Objects rolling across the floor and no one pushed them. Cold spots, rusty barking. And I saw what looked like a woman on the stairs late one night. But kind of misty. You know, a ghost. Or a poltergeist.
At that point, I figured that there might be industrial chemicals in the drinking water of Morristown, New Jersey. Or that someone was pranking me something terrible.
Whoa, that sure is something.
I am Midwestern, and that's pretty much how we respond to things like that. Sometimes we say,
Oh yeah, that's a heck of a deal.
But this wasn't the right occasion for that. I left Tim there, wide-eyed and shivering. I never did find out what my dad thought as he was still working over in Philadelphia during the day that holiday break. He does play a small role in what follows. It's now closer to New Year's and my folks invited some neighbors over for cookies and eggnog. My dad used to do a great job each year with the eggnog, but this year there was slightly less egg and more nog, if you know what I mean. We were all sitting around in the parlor, that's what you do in parlors, enjoying sugary carbs and adulterated Christmas drinks when one of the neighbors, some guy, explained the story of the house. The house that he and his wife lived in. Our house.
This house, when it was a whole house, not divided in half like it is now, was where a rich old man used to live. He got himself a young wife, one of the beauties of the town, and kept her pretty much locked up here, because he was a jealous type, and a miser. He never gave her enough money to buy all that a young woman wants or needs, and one day, he died. She lived on for many and many years, knowing that the old guy had hidden his fortune somewhere in this house, but she never could find it. She died too, but her body wasn't found until many weeks later, her arms outstretched towards the top of the stairs. She had died of starvation, or so they said, and it is a ghost that wanders through these floors, from one side of the building to the other. Searching and searching for that hidden treasure.
And then, I did something I have regretted to this day. There, in my parents' house, with invited guests in the parlor enjoying New Year's cheer, I stood up and declaimed,
Well, that's of course a great story, but there are no such things as ghosts. There are, however, hallucinations, delusions, and hypnotic suggestions. For that matter, there's no ESP, all scientifically proven.
What happened next is the regrettable part. The neighbor's face flushed red as Rudolph's nose, his shoulders raised nearly to his ears, and he pointed his finger at me as he said,
"You may be a smart college boy, but you don't know everything. My wife and I lived here for years, and whether you believe us or not, we have seen her and we believe."
And with that, not surprisingly, the party sort of broke up. I blamed the eggnog. My bedroom in this new place was on the third floor. Above me was Tim's on the fourth floor, and above that, the attic. In those days, I never traveled without my guitar. But since my dad, when he finally had time off from his work, liked to nap during the day in his room on the second floor, I was always careful to close my door. I tend to sing loudly, as some of you know. I also write songs, as it is also fairly well known. So I was sitting on my bed, noodling around with some chords and lyrics, something along the lines of,
"Oh, sweet ghost, the ghost with the most. I guess we're all toast if you're spiteful. But we'll find your money. Just ask me, ghost honey, though my nose is runny. You're delightful."
Not a great song by any means, but it's what happened next that pitched that song into the deep, dark, nevermore pit of lost projects. I was strumming and warbling away when the door to the bedroom shot open and crashed into the wall behind it.
"Okay, Tim, not funny."
I went and looked at the door, still holding my guitar. No one outside it. No string or mechanism to have popped it open or to have swung it inside with such force.
Sheesh, I'm getting betty myself.
But I thought I'd better go see if Tim was upstairs, somehow playing a trick on me. I stalked back to my bed and was about to lay the guitar back in its case when the door, like some crazy tornado, had thrust it away from the wall. Like some malevolent being unseen had anger management issues, suddenly snapped it back into its frame. And then I heard a woman crying. I rushed downstairs, found Tim and Mom chatting in the parlor, and blurted out,
Do not tell Dad. But I think..."
Well, how were the stories? I hope they spooked you. I'm kidding. Thank you very much for watching the second episode of The Dent. Make sure you let us know your thoughts down below in the comments, and beware, because you'll never know if you'll be next.